Hey, y'all. I'm so glad you came. I cannot tell you how excited I am about tonight, how heavily I have circled this message and your unseen faces in prayer. I'm so excited for what God has for us. I want to just give you a little bit of background on me, if some of y'all haven't met all of you, and I'd love to get to know all of you, but I have a background in church ministry for I don't even know how many years, y'all. I've been in the church, working inside the four walls of the church for a long time. As Luann said, I was a former Freedom Ministry pastor, teaching pastor. I've done the Connections pastor gig, you name it, I've done it. And about 2 years ago, the Lord called me out of that to dedicate my time to writing and speaking and teaching the Bible. And it's been terrifying and so rewarding. And it has been hard, but so easy at the same time. I can't really explain it. So about a year ago, I published my first book. And we did bring copies. And I do have an amazing ministry team. And they are here. Yay! And they're going to be selling the book afterwards. It's called Bare Naked Truths. 31 days devotional to stripping away the lies that derail your destiny. And so grab it, dig into it. It's a powerful tool. And then if we ever get to talk one-on-one, I can share the story of how that even came to play, because every book, I promise you, has a deep story behind why it was even written in the first place. And so that's what I do. I love studying scripture. I get the opportunity to travel. I speak at lots of different churches, at different events, retreats, conferences. Sometimes it's local. Sometimes I get to get on a plane and fly, and that's so fun. It's so fun. I love studying scripture. I love diving in to the Word of God with other women. There's just nothing more rewarding, and it's so fun. It is so fun. But I do have a confession. I love the studying, I love the teaching, I love, my favorite part is probably the prayer that goes into it, but one thing that is just sacred to me, is the afterwards, when I get to get off that platform and hug your neck and get to know your name. I love hearing women's stories. I love crying tears with them. I love giggling with them. It is amazing. But I legit, and I mean I legit, get sad every single time I have to drive away or get on a plane and leave a group of ladies, because I have not ever once met one group of ladies that I didn't wish I could have spent just a little bit more time with and gotten to know just a little bit more. And then I'll connect with them on social media and I'll see their lives from a distance and wish that I could be there for some of the things that they're posting about. But that's what makes tonight so special for me. Y'all might not care about this, but I do. What makes tonight so special for me is I don't have to leave y'all. Y'all are my home church. And so I was so excited to be able to have this opportunity. When Luann asked me, I was like, yes. So please come get to know me, because I want to get to know y'all, and I'm so, so excited about tonight. I will tell you this. I have been a Bible teacher for 7 years, and never in the history of ever has the Lord just straight up given me a message until tonight. I did not have to search this. I did not have to do hours upon hours of research. I did not have to cross-reference. I did not have to spread commentaries all out on the floor for this message. I did not have to play with words and manipulate them and try to come up with the cutest little sticky statements that would just stick in your brain so that when you walk out here, you remember that one thing that really, really was powerful. I mean, I didn't have to do hardly any of that. And I did do a little bit of research, so don't freak out on me right now. You'd be like, I don't know what you're going to say, but I might need to go right now. Okay, so I did do a little bit of research. But I am telling you something, mark my words, God has something up tonight. God has something for you tonight. And if you are in this room, you have been prayed over fervently by multiple women. This is not a mistake. This is not an accident. You are here on purpose, and He has something for us. So if you leave this place and you just feel like your soul just is refreshed and renewed, I will be honest with you, that is God, holy, 100% God and not me. And if you leave here and you think, man, that was like really boring and lame, then you need to talk to Jesus, like 100%. I don't know what's up with you. We're going to pray over you, lay hands and pull another anointing oil. All right, let's pray. Let's pray first so I don't get myself in more trouble. Jesus, we love you. There is no one like you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for each other. May we never, ever take any one of those things lightly. Lord, I have words laid out that I feel like were straight from your heart to ours. And so I just ask that you would grant me the permission to get out of your way and let the Holy Spirit do his thing. Open the eyes and the ears of our heart as we take this in. May we learn something, may we grow in you, but most importantly, Jesus, don't let us leave here the way we came in. And we trust you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Okay, so me and my family, as Luann said, we actually recently moved to Tomball from Cyprus, and we had no idea how a 25-mile move would drastically change our lives, and we did it just to be more central to life. So we're now in Tomball, and my husband's closer to work, we're closer to the kids' school, we're closer to church, I'm closer to the Woodlands Mall, and I'm really, really excited about that. It's really revolutionized the shopping habits. But we love it. We absolutely love it. We love Tomball. We love the small town feel that Tomball can bring. But of course, if you are familiar with Tomball or you've ever been to Tomball, you're probably not going to be surprised that one of the questions we kept getting asked when we move out here is, have you eaten at Mel's? Is anybody familiar with Mel's? Yes. Southern comfort food. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. So we got this question over and over again. So we just decided on a date night, like we're just going to go to Mel's Country Kitchen. That's what we're going to do. And I was actually raised to cook with bacon grease. And so we just like anytime something needs flavor, you know, you save your bacon grease, you get the tin can and you put it in the tin can and it doesn't really have an expiration date. So it might sit there for a year or two. And whenever you need flavor, you just get a spoonful and you dollop that stuff right in anything. I mean, just anything and it makes it better. So Mel's Country Kitchen, like I feel like I'm in Mimi's kitchen. Like I'm like, yes, I'm right at home. So I was all about it. So we go to Mel's, we read the menu, we sit down at the table, we order the food comes, and they set out both of our plates, and we're both just looking at it. And y'all, there is nothing on any of our plates that is not fried. It's all fried. We've got fried chicken, we've got fried fish, we've got French fries, fried okra, hush puppies, like it's all fried. And so we're just kind of looking at it and looking at each other. And my husband just takes his cap off to pray. And he just goes, Lord, do what you can with this. And we just laughed and we're like, yeah, I mean, we pretty much just ordered like gas and bloating, clogged arteries, heart attack, all on a plate. And then we're going to ask Jesus to bless it. Yes, bless that, Lord. So we eat the food. But you know what? There was something about those words, and I don't know, I can't explain why, but I just couldn't shake that prayer that he prayed. You know, something that was so light and funny. And I went home, and I don't know why, it was just on my mind. And the more I processed and the more I thought about that prayer, Lord, do what you can with this, I was able to pinpoint, like, that's actually kind of the cry of my heart. And I never really realized it. I can't tell you how often I find myself, my sin, my failures, my human nature welling up. And I just look at Jesus and say, Lord, do what you can with this. I've spent the majority of my life second guessing myself, not always feeling like I measure up. I can convince myself that God's plans and purposes and promises work for everybody but me. So I usually shrink back when God is calling me to step up because I have this tendency to look at everything in my life that is unhealthy and doesn't seem good for any kind of spiritual growth and think, I don't know that God can use any of this. I don't even know if he would want any of this. We actually have a video that I want to show you guys that'll kind of summarize exactly what that feels like.
It was my choice. And now I will question myself for the next few weeks, maybe month.
We had an option of two pathways to walk, and they led to two doorways.
It was a bit confronting, actually, to be honest, to see these big signs and feeling like you had to choose and be self-conscious of how you perceive yourself and perhaps if it lines up with how the rest of the world perceives you.
I went through the average door.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. I didn't even hesitate.
漂亮对我的概念来说就是像明星那种遥不可及的那种。我走的是一般。
Mas eu acho que é mais porque eu me arrependi da escolha, porque era diferente do que eu vivo, é diferente do que eu sou.
Am I choosing because of what's constantly bombarded at me, what I'm being told that I should accept? Or am I choosing because that's what I really believe?
I walked into that door with said average, and I didn't feel really good after that, because obviously I had rated myself average and nobody else.
Todos os dias eu passo pela porta comum e ontem foi um dia único e eu optei por passar pelo bonita.
I wanted to go through the average door, but my mom just pulled me over to the beautiful door.
It was quite a triumphant feeling. It was like telling the world, I think I'm beautiful.
I just wish more young women realized it.
要是再给我一次机会走那扇门的话，我觉得我应该会选很美的扇门。
I think I would walk through the beautiful door.
Yeah. Acho que a porta bonita tá completamente aberta para mim.
Maybe I could walk in that door.
You can.
Next time I look into the mirror, I will see somebody really beautiful looking back at me.
Beautiful is a great word. So why not see what's on the other side of that?
That's a Dove commercial. I could watch Dove commercials all day long. They are so good. Okay, be honest. Which one of you would have walked through the average door? Totes, I would have too. Hands down, I would have walked through the average door. The thing is, it all depends on whose definition of beautiful you're subscribing to. How many of you just wanted to jump in to that commercial, that footage, and just grab some of those women and like push them through the door? Like, what are you thinking, walking through the average door? The one that just got me was the girl that was walked up and then she saw both of them and was like, no, I'm not doing this today. And she walked off. I get her. I'm with her. I'm going to follow her. The thing is it takes courage to walk through the right door. A lot of courage. And so we are about to become good friends and well acquainted with a woman whose whole story revolves around walking through the right door. And so if you brought your Bible, like physical Bible, we are going to be in Luke 7. For those of y'all who need to use the table of contents, use your table of contents. This is like a safe zone. So don't worry about that. Matthew, Mark, Luke, third book of the New Testament. We're going to be in Luke 7, 36 through 50. Now, if you have your phone, your smartphone, your digital phone, click on ESV, if you would. I'm just going to read this particular passage out of the English Standard Version. You probably will follow a lot better if you're on the same version as I am. This is the story of the sinful woman. If I could, I would totally rename this to the story of the courageous woman, but I'm not allowed to do that because I'm not God and I don't know better. And so her name is the sinful woman. That's actually all we know really about her, the sinful woman. And so we're going to read a little bit about her. You'll find out why exactly she's called the sinful woman here in a minute. Luke 7, starting in 36. One of the Pharisees asked him, and I want to clarify, him is Jesus. So one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. Let's stop real quick because we're actually going to read all the way down. But I want us to all be on the same page. Stopped him, went into the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. So let's all get on the same page. Where is Jesus? He is actually inside the house at the table. And behold, a woman of the city, everybody say woman of the city, who was a sinner, when she learned that he was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment, and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair on her head and kissed his feet and anointed them with ointment. So Jesus is in the house. She is outside of the house until she does what? Walks through the door. She had the courage to walk through the door. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him in saw this, he said to himself, he's thinking in his head, if this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is, who is touching him, for she is a sinner. He had already labeled this woman. And Jesus answering said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he answered, yes, say it, teacher. A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which one of them will love him more? Simon answered, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. And he said to him, you have judged rightly. Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, and don't miss this, do you see this woman? I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much. Like, I so want Jesus to say that about me one day. She loved much. But he who has forgiven little loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. Then those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, who is this? Who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Now, whenever I read scripture, I tend to just have like all these questions that just swarm my head that I can't get out of. And so I've just fallen in love with this passage lately, and I read it and I have so many questions like, what's her name? How old is she? Was she literally the only woman in the room? How did she know Jesus was there? We don't really know any of that. And I wish we did. But what we do know, we can break down. We know that one, she had a reputation. She lived an incredibly immoral, sinful life as her profession was prostitution. It was a chosen lifestyle. It was not forced. You know the job description, right? And she was in the home of a Pharisee who, quite frankly, was disgusted by her. Now, here's something important for you to know. We can read a story of a woman washing Jesus' feet in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We will read a story of a woman anointing his feet in all four Gospels. Matthew, Mark, and John describe the same instance, but Luke, this story that we're studying tonight, is a very different instance. It's a very different scenario. Matthew, Mark, and John actually name the woman. She has a name. Her name is Mary. They're in Bethany, and we can see by just exegeting scripture that they are at the end of Jesus's ministry. But our unnamed woman, the one we're studying right now, all we know about her is she's the sinful woman. This would have taken place in or around Galilee, and it was at the very beginning of Jesus's ministry. So we've got two women, similar stories, but this one, I'm going to dare say to you, took just a little bit greater of a risk to do what she did. So I really want us to walk this out. In fact, like, I want you to just wrap your mind around what was happening. So, like, picture this, and let's walk this out with her from the door all the way to Jesus's feet. I want you to jump in the story, be a fly on the wall, do whatever you need to do to walk this out. This was a very public dinner. This time was set aside for the more prestigious, the higher-ups, the somebodies in the town. And in this particular culture, that meant men. So we can pretty much deduct that she was very, very, very uninvited. And homegirl finds a way to just march herself in there and plop herself down at the feet of Jesus like it's nothing. The only thing is, I don't really think it went down like that. Think about what it would have been like for her to just walk over the threshold. I mean, this was a really, really big deal. I don't know how else to explain it other than maybe this would have been equivalent to her walking in the men's locker room. Except for nobody wanted her there. They all knew who she was. Can you just picture what that would have looked like? Can you just imagine in your stomach the guts it would have taken that she would have had to work up just to walk in? I mean, she had to make her way past every single one of those men, the shock on their faces, the snickers filling the room, the whispering among each other, the blatant rejection of who she was as a person. She heard it all. Oh, she was very aware. And here she goes, making her way past every hurtful word, unfair opinion, unjust thing that was ever said to her, judgment, criticism, you name it. Oh, I can imagine. I can imagine what that must have felt like. Can you? I bet there were so many knots in her stomach, yet she somehow found a way to fight her way through that crowd to get to Jesus. And I just picture her just walking past each man and looking at them and saying, I see the look on your face of disapproval. I see you rolling your eyes. I see it. I hear your demeaning words. I know you think I don't belong, but I didn't come here for you. I came here for him. And she kneels at his feet with real pain and real shame as real regret rolls down her cheeks. So much so that the tears were enough to wet his feet. So that she had to dry them with her hair. I can just hear her prayer. Jesus, I'm here. I love you. Do what you can with this. In one moment, the sinful woman became the forgiven woman. But not just the forgiven woman. She became the forgiven woman who loved much. Don't tell me that Jesus doesn't defend us when we come to him. That he doesn't have the ability to look deep within us and see beautiful things inside of us when we cannot see them ourselves. But then it doesn't stop there. She then proceeds to anoint his feet, to wash his feet, and put perfume on his feet. Y'all, this was the good stuff. I just want you to know. I know all y'all out there have your Nordstrom perfume that's really nice, and then you have your Target brand perfume that's really nice. My girls are always trying to get into my Gucci, and I'm like, you can have Taylor Swift. Put that bottle down, pick that bottle up. I don't think so, sister, right? But she brought the good stuff, the most expensive stuff. This wasn't just any perfume she brought to the feet of Jesus. This was actually her signature scent. This was her calling card. She put this on when she wanted men to know that she was available for hire. It's how she got her business. So when she was bringing this to the feet of Jesus, she was bringing her financial security, her reputation, the identity that she had carried for so dang long. She was bringing every label she had ever accepted as true in her life, every outlandish hope and dream she had for the future, and she just put it all at the feet of Jesus. And all she could do was just offer her best. Do you want to know why this moment was so precious? Because she didn't go to get something from Jesus. She went to give him something. Her heart. This was called letting go, and it was an act of surrender, and it was an act of worship. But it wasn't because she was worthy. It's because he was. And as we study this, let's just be so very careful to not make this story about her. You know, there is a lot of self-help talk out there right now that we're all hearing. We're all hearing it. If you're on social media, you're hearing it. If you're around other women, you're hearing it. And we are bombarded with messages right now that say things like, you do you. You take the bull by the horn. You do what makes you happy. You be the hero of your own story. Girls, we are not the heroes of our own story. Jesus is the hero. He is always the hero. We were never created to be the hero of our story. We never will. That's why we need a savior. We must be so careful to check our theology when we hear messages coming at us like this. Because you know what? They might be really good, but they're not the gospel. You have to know the difference. If it's about us, it'll make us prideful. If it's about him, it'll make us purposeful. That's how we can tell the difference. And I want you to know that our purpose will require us to make the same exact decision that that woman made. Am I here for you, or am I here for him? Because we'll all be called to that. I'm going to go out on a limb here and just guess that maybe, just maybe, our unnamed woman did not feel like walking through the door that day. Something tells me she was not feeling good enough. She probably did not want to walk through that door and face those people to sit at the feet of Jesus thinking, oh dear Lord, it's Jesus. I mean, it's Jesus. We often feel inadequate, don't we? Less than an average. And I don't really think that we should deny that we feel that way. I actually think that it's okay to feel that way. What's not okay is we need to deny the lie that's making us feel that way. So it's not okay to just let it sit there. As women, I know and you know when someone or something triggers an insecurity in us, don't we? We know rejection. We know defeat. We know what it feels like to be paralyzed by perfection, right? We know what it feels like to be sidetracked by striving and to become obsessed with outcome. all these things are so very familiar to us. And the dialogue that runs in our head that causes us to question ourselves every day. Does this person like me? Does this person think less of me? Is this person trying to take my place? Right? And all these questions just bombard us. 2 Corinthians 10:5 says, take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. I have sometimes just have to go back to that and just dwell on it. Because questioning, really, it's only dangerous when we're asking the wrong ones. It's okay to question the thoughts in our head. But the way that I've learned to question it is, where did this thought come from? Who's saying it to me? And why do they have a right to say it to me? And so when I feel doubt and insecurity and failure rise up in me, I have to just stop and say, where is this coming from? Why is this even here in the first place? Because the fact is, we do worry about what other people think of us. Can I get an amen? Amen. Like, it can really weigh heavy on us. And then what do we do with that? Sometimes we can learn more from what people don't do more than anything. And so I want to tell you what our girl in Luke 7 did not do. She did not expend any energy trying to fight their opinion and change their minds. She simply pushed past it. She doesn't defend herself. She doesn't strike back. Girl, she doesn't even respond. Why is that? Because her original intent for entering that room wasn't to consult anybody in that room but Jesus. Doesn't mean it didn't hurt. Doesn't mean it didn't bother her. It just means it didn't make her forget why she came in the first place. There's something that I can guarantee you about pursuing Jesus. At some point, we will all be misread. We will all be misunderstood, and our motives will be questioned. In fact, 1 Thessalonians 3:4 says it like this, for you yourselves know that we are destined for this. There will be accusations, assumptions, name-calling, mudslinging, and we are going to have to push through it because the only other option is getting caught up in it. And when we get caught up in it, we somehow miss that door to get to Jesus. Listen, not every critical word spoken to us or about us merits a response. We take them to his feet with the reality that just because we're not perfect doesn't mean we're not purposed. He uses it all. Look how he used her life. I want you to look at what Jesus does next because this has got to be my most favorite part of the story. Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. Jesus pushed back. He pushed back on their cultural norms. He pushed back on their religious limitations and their lofty opinions. And he said, yeah, but do you see her? And he told them, like, what? Just look at her. Quit dehumanizing her and just look at her. The Pharisees had invited Jesus in and failed to honor him. It would have been very customary in this time for them to offer him a kiss when he walked through the door and either wash his feet for him or offer him water to wash his feet. Everything that he is rattling off, offering oil to anoint his head. It's all customary. And they missed it. They missed it. And I have read so many different thoughts and opinions on why did they even invite him in the first place? And some of them said maybe they were trying to impress him. Some thought patterns say maybe they were just sizing him up. Others say he was growing in popularity, and maybe they were trying to gather evidence against him to make themselves feel better about themselves. But either way, they were seeking validation, but she was seeking transformation. And she got it. Like, she got it. Beware when someone wants a place in his kingdom that isn't at his feet. He says, do you see this woman? Do you see what I see? Simon saw a prostitute. Jesus saw a person. Simon saw her habits. Jesus saw her heart. Simon pushed her away because of her sin, and Jesus pulled her really, really close. But there are two people that Jesus is addressing in this story right now. He's talking to the accuser, Simon, and he's talking to the accused. And girls, we're both. We are both. Jesus is challenging us to look at others and see what he sees. Give them a chance. Give them a second thought. Give them a hand. Give them grace. There is not one person that you will look in the eyes that God does not love. So let's get real for a hot second. Because we established, like, this is home church for me. This is home church for most of y'all. So since this is home church, can this be like sister to sister talk real quick? You know how that goes? Like, you just say it. You just say it like it is and hope and pray that your sister will receive it because you just love each other anyway. Okay, let's get real for a hot second. Snarky comments, the silent treatment, not acknowledging someone's presence, refusing to cheer someone on, intentionally leaving someone out. Don't pretend like you haven't done it. We have all done it in this room, right? Y'all are sitting there like, me? Like, I will call you a liar to your face. I will do it. Jesus, girls, hear me. Don't do it. Push back on this kind of behavior. Push back on how the enemy wants you to behave and act and treat each other. We are not each other's enemies. We're just not. Push back when you're tempted to compare. Push back when you find yourself in a full-blown competition with somebody else. Push back when the enemy tells you that you're not enough, you're worthless, you'll never be different, things will never change for you. You push back, whether it is the person in front of you, the person behind you, or the person in the mirror, you push back until you see what God sees. That's what Jesus said to do. He said, look at her. Look at her. Becoming the woman that God created you to be will require an open heart and a backbone. And I want to show you something. You're going to find both of those things right here. At his feet, on your knees. If we are going to move the kingdom of heaven forward, we are going to have to take our place in this world like the sinful woman did. Her destiny was her decision. This book, it's a book of promises. Absolutely. But more than anything, this book right here is a book of choices. And your destiny is your decision. In fact, Jesus says, I set before you life and death. Choose life. Always, always, always choose the door that honors Jesus. Always choose the door that brings you to your knees and makes you stand in awe of him and say, I wouldn't have gotten here, Lord, if it weren't for you. But here I am. I love you. Do what you can with this. I want to leave you with this. It's a little bit longer of a scripture, but it is probably one of the most powerful things that we can read at the moment. We're going to be in Hebrews 4, 12 through 16, and this is where we're going to wrap it up. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even dividing the soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him who we must give account. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. And here is what I want you to take. I want you to underline it. I want you to highlight it. I want you to memorize it. Let us then approach God's throne with grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Walk through the door. Walk through the right door. Walk through the door that gets you to Jesus. Some of y'all just need to walk through it. But you must know one thing. The greatest and highest accomplishments in our lives will be reached on our knees. So you go after Jesus with everything you've got. Let's pray. Jesus, there is no one like you. No one, no one, no one like you. You open the door to us when every other door is closed. You welcome us when other people shrug their shoulders. You hold us when we need you. There is no sin that is too great that you cannot forgive. And tonight I pray, Lord, that if there's any areas in our life that we have not turned over to you, any jar of perfume that we have not been willing to completely break at your feet, will you just show us? Because I want tonight to be a night where we give it all to you, like all in. All in. Open our eyes to see your glory. We need to see you in ways we've never seen you before. Allow us to do that, Lord. Help us to see others the way you do. To let them in when we're tempted to shut them out. Help us to see the beauty in the people that you place around us. And Lord, my prayer over all of us tonight, when we go home, we're looking in the mirror, we're taking off all that makeup, would you just show us? Give us a glimpse. Give us a word. Give us a feeling. Help us, Lord, to see in ourselves what you see. May we always be women who boldly approach God's throne of grace with confidence We love you, Jesus.